Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. About earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading appointed for this Sunday is taken from the book of Jonah. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, Is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, It is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, Is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm reading appointed for today is taken from Psalm 145. We shall read it in unison. Together, I will exalt you, O God, my King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day will I bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. There is no end to his greatness. One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your power. I will ponder the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works. They shall speak of the might of your wondrous acts, and I will tell of your greatness. They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing your righteous deeds. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and of great kindness. The second reading appointed for today is taken from the letter of Paul to the church at Philippi. Paul writes, for to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only, live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that, whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing. For he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'Those last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be ever acceptable to you, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. For those of you who may have traveled through Europe, and if you're like some of us, you end up going in and out of a lot of churches. And there are some interesting pulpits in those churches in Europe. One type of pulpit in particular you actually will see from time to time, and it actually is a fish, a giant fish, that is almost sitting upright as if it is about to breach the waters, right? Charging up and breaching the waters. And the point of having that large giant fish as a pulpit is so that in this particular processing of coming to you and offering the word, the preacher actually has to go inside and walk, turning inside the actual belly of the whale, so to speak, before coming up and out and offering the grace that God has to give. It's a beautiful way and thoughtful way of what it means to preach, going through that belly of the whale. But it really, truly is not all preachers that have to do that. I think all of us as people need to actually do that in our own sitting with Scripture, in our own offering and opening up our heart to take in God's Word. We need to allow it to penetrate. We need to allow it to work inside of us so that we can begin to understand more fully who we are. And I think most importantly, whose we are. Jonah was an interesting character. He was an interesting prophet in the Bible. and it's an absolutely beautiful three, four chapters in which to read. We have turned it into, culturally, a children's story, but it is anything but a child's story. This wonderful, interesting curmudgeon of a prophet knew exactly who God was. He knew exactly who it is that God offered himself out into the world, full of love, full of grace. And yet Jonah still went the other way. We actually don't find out until this very piece of scripture why. Jonah, after reluctantly saying yes to God in the call that he had to go to Nineveh and speak God's word for the people to change their ways, he said yes to God, and then he went off and turned the other way. He went in the exact opposite direction of where it was that God had asked him to go. And through the story of his tumultuous falling out of the boat, jumping out of the boat, all of the pieces that happened, ending up inside the belly of the whale, only to have this very God that he walked away from meet him right in that very spot. And not only offer him the love and forgiveness he needed, but to give him another opportunity to go and do exactly what he was originally called to do. And still with a great deal of reluctance, that's exactly what Jonah did. He went and he spoke to the people. He told them exactly what it was that God wanted him to do. And then he went and plopped himself off somewhere to sit and watch, to see what was going to happen, to see what he knew was going to happen. In the fact that when the people heard God's word, when they made the choice to make the changes in their life that they needed to do, God did exactly what Jonah knew he would do. God forgave them. God offered them acceptance and love that was not deserved. That's what grace is. It's acceptance and love that is undeserved for whatever reason, and yet still fully given, still fully offered. But here's the interesting thing about Jonah. He knew God. He knew who God was. But he did not accept God's choice to offer his grace out to the world. And so that is really the crux. And although he may have been inside the belly of the whale in his running from God, the reality is he ended right back in the belly of the whale because he could not accept the true love of God, the true acceptance that God has for all people. And so it's an interesting thing when we take a look at this, because even within the same gospel story, thousands of years later from the allegory that we just received in the book of Jonah, here we now have a parable that is offered to us from Jesus, teaching the very same lesson of God's grace being offered out into the world to the undeserved, to the people who don't know God that well. And here we're hearing this in the story of people who give themselves all day long in work, and then people who give half day's work, and then people who just sort of come in at the end of the day, offer an hour, maybe less, and at the end of the day, everyone is given the very same thing. Everyone is offered the exact same opportunity. Each person, whether they put in a full day's work in this field or came at the end of the day, still received the feeding that they needed. And people grumbled about that. There were a lot of Jonas in this parable. People who felt that they deserved more than was offered out to people who already had less. It's a continual story that we have of not only not necessarily understanding the point of God's grace. It's one thing to not understand God's grace. It's a whole other thing to not desire and want God's grace for others. We see this in the world today. We see this in our divisions that we have.
We see this in the fact that whether or not we are of one orientation or another, that people don't think the same group of people deserve exactly what it is that they already have. We see it in the colors of us all from all around the world. We don't feel that people who are as good as us deserve the same loving grace that God has to offer. And even a little maybe closer to home, now that we're in the throes of an election, we take a look at the divisions that we have just within the voting process. And we are so angry at the other group of people that we don't want good for them. We want to see something terrible happen to those people who think differently than maybe we do. It's all the same thing. And we have to take a look at ourselves and how we are stepping into our knowledge of God, our acceptance of God's grace and love, not only for ourselves, but for all of those others in the world. We are asked to be Christ in this world. You will continue to hear that from me on and on and on. But the idea of being Christ in the world is offering the very love and grace that God offers each and every one of us. It can be a tough thing. First, we have to understand it. We need to accept it for ourselves, but then we need to look up and we need to look around. We have to take a look at what's going on within our own lives. Where are we being Jonah? Where are we out in our not only the world, but in our personal relationships, and in those relationships as we look out into the world and see a whole group of people that we don't agree with? At what point do we sit and choose to be Jonah in this world, knowing God, but not offering God? And at what point in this world do we truly choose to be Christ? You know, at the end of the book of Jonah, God actually asks a question. Should I not be concerned of all these, I think it was 120,000 people, should I not be concerned of all of these other people that you feel don't deserve my grace? Should I not be concerned for them as well? That's the question that he asked of Jonah. And the interesting thing is that in all of the books of the Bible, every single book of the Bible, Jonah is the only book that ends in an actual question. And the reason it offers up and kind of ends in that question is because the story has not ended. The question is for us to answer. The question is for us to live into. The question is for us to realize in our lives. Should I not be concerned? Amen. Standing, my friends, let us all come together in your homes, whether you'd like to be kneeling or standing or within the concepts of your entire heart. Let us now step forward and say the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the way of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. We especially pray for those affected by the floods, hurricanes, and fires. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. We pray for those serving in our armed forces. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, praying especially for those named on our prayer list. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially Elizabeth Tilly Burton, in whose loving memory the altar flowers have been given, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, who created all peoples in your image, we thank you for the wonderful diversity of races and cultures in this world and the grace that you offer each and every person. Enrich our lives by ever widening circles of friend fellowship, and show us your presence in those who differ most from us, until our knowledge of your love is made perfect in our love for all people. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And my friends, may the peace of the Lord be with each and every one of you.
Also
with you.
Thank you.
goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." According to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your own creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit down upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. And in the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the prophet Jonah, and all of your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and your daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
My friends, as promised, I want to always keep you up to date. Last weekend, we had one of the most wonderful meetings of our regathering committee and also conversation with our vestry about how we are to move forward safely in wanting to come together, desiring to come together once again in in-person worship. And although it won't look the same, we will continue to do exactly what we're doing here with taping the service so that all can enjoy it from wherever they are. But we are taking a look and putting before the bishop a plan. And we do kind of expect that the bishop is going to be very supportive in honoring that plan, but it is going to take the next couple of weeks before that gets in front of him and then he's able to take a look at it and we come back together. So look for information coming very shortly. And how that we might be able to continue and begin to open up these doors, begin to be able to see your face as we're all here together in the church. And we're all very excited about that. Just need your patience a little bit longer. But know that as your church leadership came together in the past week, it was a glorious time, a good conversation. And I think the very grace of God that I spoke about today was a part of all of that dialogue. One thing that we are going to be able to do, and I'm very excited about this, but in the next few weeks, the first weekend in October, is a feast day of St. Francis, which for us here in the church is not only lifting up the wonderful saint, but also all the little saints that kind of bark and meow and some of them chirp. And so you will be seeing information coming up on both October 3rd and 4th, where both at St. George's as well as here at All Saints, we are going to be offering out a blessing of the animals. And we will be looking to do that in a very, very safe way. What better way to finally be in person than to be with the very creatures of God that we were created here as human beings? We were put here on earth to take care of those creatures. And so I can't think of a better way to begin to regather than to regather with our little ones first. I pray that you have a beautiful week, a grace-filled week, with the blessing of God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit to be upon you each and every day. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.